Bam! I'm Mr. Taru, back for part two of comparing and really defining the differences between the two types of variables that we're going to learn, or the two types of variables we have in statistics, continuous random variables, which granted is most of the type of problems we deal with, and a discrete random variable. And we have this PDF table set up for the number of TVs in a household. So we're about to scan over to the next panel of notes, and we're going to be talking about continuous random variables. That means that we're going to bring up one more time bell curves and z-score calculations, and that z-score calculation is going to get repetitive or get repeated many, many times now in the second half of our intro to statistics class. But let's remind ourselves of finding maybe some probabilities that we did in our probability chapter, the last chapter. Like, what is the probability that X equals, let's say, 1? What's the probability that a household has exactly 1 TV in the house? Well, that's 16% based on this data, which honestly I did make up for this lecture. What is the probability that X is greater than 1? Well, that's going to be, well, all my outcomes that are greater than 1. And just like we did when we first learned probabilities and we set up these probability models in the last chapter, more than 1 is just 0.37, now it's 0.57, 58, 68, 75, 76%. So the probability based on this made-up data that a household has more than 1 TV is 76%. What's the probability that a household has 1 or more TVs? You know, that I bring in this equal sign, and now I ask for the probability. Well, that's going to be the complement. The probability of 1 or more is the complement of having no TVs. And having no TVs, well, that's 8% of the population we are guessing or estimating from our sample. So the probability of having 1 or more is 92%. Okay, the reason why I'm bringing up these probability questions and reminding you of some of the questions you might have learned when you learned basic probabilities, those basic probability rules last chapter, is we're going to now move into the topic of a continuous random variable. And a continuous random variable is when we did the z-score calculations. And when we talk about z-score calculations, we have to be reminded of how to prove that data is normal. And don't forget, we have univariate quantitative data that's normal. That's a mathematical model. And when you have this perfectly mathematical model that can take on an infinite number of x values, you know, you would not actually be able to find something like the probability that x equals a specific number. You will not be able to find these two probabilities if it were a continuous random variable or an estimation used or made by using the z-score calculation. These would actually be the same answer in a bell curve z-score calculation. But when you have a nice PDF that you can just pull probabilities out of, yes, indeed, you can find the probability that x equals a specific number. And these two inequalities, x is greater than 1 and x is greater than or equal to 1, will of course yield you different answers, because we can see that the probability that x equals 1 does have value and thus changes the answer as we introduce this equal sign. Okay, so enough of this panel of notes. Let's do the last one. Okay, so, bam, last page. Very easy to make histograms by hand when given a probability distribution, just that we just saw with the numbers of TVs in a single household, because they're telling you, like, you know, here's your x value, 0, 1, 2, 3, very precise. And, by the way, the probability of a 0 and the probability of a 1 and the probability of a 2 is blah, blah, blah. So when you're given such nice, clear information, if asked to make a histogram, please just make it by hand. Don't bother making a calculator or having a calculator do it for you. With discrete random variables, you know, the x values being nice, clear, concise, individual outcomes, it also makes a little bit more sense to just put those numbers right in the center of the histogram. Normally, our numbers are on the divider lines, so if you've forgotten some of your concepts from very early in the chapter, like how to set up a histogram or how to calculate z-score values, you might want to go back and rewatch those videos as well to remind yourself of how to do these problems. Or of course, you know, read your book. Hopefully that'll help as well. Okay, type 2 of the variable. Continuous random variable. Takes on all values in an interval of numbers. All values, not specific countable values. So within whatever interval is appropriate for your word problem, maybe it's just simply 10 to 20, the value, the x variable or the random variable can take on all and any values between, you know, whatever your min and max value is, if there even is a hard set interval, which in a continuous random variable by theory there really is not. So there's an infinite number of possibilities that x can take on, or values. The probability distribution cannot be put into a nice clear PDF table like a discrete random variable. So that means that we can only describe a continuous random variable with a density curve. And you remember what a density curve is, right? It doesn't have to be a nice bell-shaped curve. A density curve could be in the shape of a rectangle. It could be in the shape of a triangle. If it is the shape of a rectangle, then every value between, let's say, 0 and 2 as an example, would have exactly the same possibility of occurring because the graph is flat along the top. All you need for a density curve is that the area equals 1. So if you have a rectangle with a width of 2, its height is only going to be 1/2 because the area must be 1. That's really the only characteristic, defining characteristic of a density curve. The area is 1. Now, if you have these crazy geometric shapes, I don't know if a rectangle is all that crazy, you just find the area by doing length times width. I just said find the area by doing length times width. If you have a bell curve density curve, or a bell-shaped density curve, you have to find the area under the curve by calculating the z-score calculation, the z-score, and then looking up that z-score formula to find, you know, maybe some tail areas. If you have a rectangular density curve that represents a completely random variable where every outcome is equally likely, you just do length times width. Or maybe you have a triangular shape and you're doing 1/2 base times height. So don't think every time you see the word density curve, you do a z-score calculation. That is only when you go back and you start reviewing your idea of a density curve that is normal, okay? So if you have a normal density curve, then your z-score is equal to your statistic minus your parameter over the standard deviation of your statistic. We really have only seen this equation in the form of x minus mu over standard deviation, but now we're starting to get into the textbook and really getting close to the real meaty questions where we're going to work with means and two means at the same time and proportions. And hey, by the way, do you remember that previous window where I showed you how to find the mean and standard deviation of a discrete random variable? All those little like miniature formulas and all those formulas for standard deviation are going to start getting plugged into this z-score formula, or what's called on your AP exam formula sheet, the standardized test statistic. And it doesn't always say a z-score because you will be also learning about something called a t-score. And they don't just simply say x minus mu over sigma, because you're starting to learn now in these following chapters some different formulas to find a mean and to find a standard deviation. And those formulas simply get plugged into this outline that we have. Okay, so you're going to be doing a lot of z-score calculations again, so if you like that part of statistics, well, congratulations, it's coming back. Don't forget that in a z-score calculation setting, that is a continuous random variable, it is a mathematical model, and x can take on, again, I just said this a second ago, an infinite number of possibilities. So when you start seeing z-scores and bell curves, don't forget that the probability that x is equal to a specific value is 0 because it's 1 over an infinity, an infinite number of possibilities. And when you're doing a continuous random variable, don't forget that the probability that x is greater than a number or less, and the probability that x is greater than or equal to a number, or it could be in the other direction, less than or equal to, are going to have exactly the same answer. You didn't see that when we did the example about the discrete random variable. talking about normality, the definition of normality is, again, you're defined by your empirical rule. Within one standard deviation, you have 68% of your data. Within two standard deviations, you have 95% of your data. And within three standard deviations, you have 99.7% of your data. If you've forgotten the graph that your calculator can make for you to automatically check for normality, then read in your book or go find a past video about a graph called a normal probability plot, which is where you graph the univariate quantitative data. The x's are going to be graphed on either the x or y axis, and the other axis, I think when I did my notes, the data was on the x axis. The other axis is going to display the z scores. And when you put your univariate data on one axis and compare it to the z scores, your normal probability plot should be showing a roughly linear pattern. And if it does show that, then your original data was therefore approximately normal. Let's see. Don't forget that if you, your number summary for a normal distribution is the mean and the standard deviation. So when you see capital N 0, 1, well, the capital N just means that you have a normal distribution. And if you have a normal distribution with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1, that's the standard normal distribution. That is the distribution of z-scores. That's the z-score table in the front of your textbook that you use every time you calculate the z-score. So I verbally reviewed quite a few concepts. I hope that I've made some sense out of this stuff, and go do your homework. Woo! Mr. Teru is out.
Thank you for watching again. I really appreciate it, and I do appreciate all the positive feedback you guys are giving me on these stats videos and that they're helping you out. You can return the favor by please spreading the word about these and allow me to help as many people as possible. Thank you very much.